Faces. So for today's sermon, I'm actually going to do a continuation of the one that Pastor Susie preached. If you remember last week, she preached on that epic divine moment in which Jesus receives the affirmation of the Father. He says, what? What does he say? My son in whom I'm well pleased. The baptism moment in which he receives the ultimate affirmation of him, his life, and that would be the propelling word unto his ministry. She also threw out the bombshell that in the same way that God the Father feels about Jesus, we actually, if we have the truth of God hitting our heart, that can be true for us as well. John 15 actually says that with the measure that the Father loves Jesus, that's the way that he feels about us as well. And so I love how the New Living Translation says, in whom I'm well pleased, it says, the one who gives me great joy. It's not about our performance, how we're doing. It's actually just how God the Father feels about us, how our daddy feels about us. And this morning, actually, before coming here, I was taking a bath with my daughter, which is such a privilege. And I was actually kind of silly, but I was like praying this over her. I said, you are my son in whom I'm well pleased. You remember that the daughter, you can be a son, right? Pastor Susie said that. I felt a little weird saying it, but I'm just in faith taking what she said. It's true that daughters have sonship. That's the purpose. And at the end of the day, it's my joy as a dad to want to give her all that I have, both financially, spiritually, everything. I want to gladly share my inheritance with her, regardless of when she's being naughty, when she's being mean. Actually, my wife Amy is getting kind of strict with me because she feels like I'm too lax of a dad. That even when she's totally not listening to me and she's throwing a tantrum, I'm still like, you're so cute. And I know that long term for her development, I need to probably, you know, get a little more strict, but that's just the reality. I'm so caught up in the season of love. My daughter is 2 years old. And so anyways, I was even praying this over her and just feeling the Father's heart. When you're a father, you can actually have greater revelation, I feel like, of how the Father feels about us. That Pastor Susie shared with her own father and that journey when her dad, you know, when she was born and her dad goes out, disappears and buys her these brand new earrings. And Pastor Susie's mom like was freaking out. Where did my husband disappear to? And it's because he was so overcome with emotion and joy for this new daughter that was born. And so anyways, I'm experiencing some of that in the season and connecting with how Father God feels about me, how my daddy feels about me. And I feel like even in Korean, this is important to say, you know, in Korean culture and churches, you only hear 하나님 아버지, which is true, our dad. But in Hebrew, it's actually Abba, which is Korean Appa. And that may feel strange to hear, but that's actually the same offensiveness in which the Hebrew heart would have heard it as well. You're talking about the separate God, the far away God, and now you're saying, this is your Appa? It's so intimate, it's so tender, and that captures the Father's heart towards us. And so in this picture, I've been just meditating and thinking about receiving that truth. But then at the same time, the other aspect of this truth is what Pastor Susie said about negative self-talk to herself. I felt like that was also freeing to hear that, to realize, oh, she goes through that as well. She said, if I talk to other people in the way that I talk to myself, I would have no friends. And many of us, we fall into this trap of being really harsh on ourselves, mean to ourselves. And it's truth. That it's proof that we have not received that revelation of how the Abba Father feels about me as well. And so I'm also going to share about that today, about the other side of the coin, about sometimes the negative self-talk we have, and also how Satan actually propels that, how he fuels that, how he speaks the lies to counteract the very truth that God spoke to Jesus about how he is our Abba Father. When heaven opens, so does hell. You know, last week I felt like it was the ordination service of Jesus. Have you ever been to an ordination service? before. We went to Pastor Caleb's ordination service, pastor in Busan, and went to his service, and it's this huge moment, especially in Korea, or maybe in English you can call yourself a pastor, but in Korean you're just a chundosa, until that moment when you receive the laying on of hands, and now I am a moksa, right? It's that divine moment in which Jesus becomes the moksanim. And so you would think when you become a moksanim, now you're ready to go back to your campus, now you're ready to lead your flock, now you're going to start the real ministry. And we often talk about the baptism moment as the moment that starts his ministry. And that's true, but it's not the ministry how we often think. Actually, the ministry that then comes is the Spirit leading him to the wilderness to be attacked by the devil. Yay, you're ordained, you're a moksanim. Now it's time for spiritual warfare straight to the devil. That's how God the Father, that's how the Abba Father led Jesus. That's pretty intense truth. Heaven opening and then hell's response. And so here's the thing, here's the reason that we're going to see this attack in Luke chapter 4. We're going to turn to in just a minute. The truth is Satan hates this revelation in your hearts. He will do whatever he can, take whatever method he can to oppose you embracing this full truth of your identity before God. This full truth that he is your Abba Father and that he delights in you, even in your weakness, even when you don't deserve it. That's how God the Father feels about you. And that's actually the end time passage. I can't help myself but share end time passages as we've been going through the end from the beginning. Romans chapter 8, verse 19 says, all creation is eagerly waiting for the revelation of the sons of God. That the whole world, humans, creation, animals, the plant life, actually it says that the key to changing everything that was turned into curse is through the blood of Jesus when the sons of God come to understanding that he's my Abba Father. This is actually the end time promise that will change everything. We had previously talked about praying for Israel, and Pastor Susie mentioned one of the stumbling blocks of praying for Israel is, well, how does God feel about me? Where does that leave me? I'm Korean, I'm American, I don't necessarily have any of this Jewish background and perspective, and then I see how God feels about the Jewish people. What about me? What about me? And the reality is, if we understand that he's our Abba Father and that he delights in you the same way that the Father delights in Jesus, you will suddenly be free of all that concern about caring for somebody else, like, oh, that means God loves me less. This is actually the key to all of our pursuit of building up the church, praying for the salvation of Israel, is understanding who you are before your Father. And Satan understands that, and he does not want the revelation of the sons of God from happening. And so he will attack it the moment after God speaks this truth to your life. And so if you were touched by the message last week, if your heart was changed even slightly, you can expect that Satan will come back against you and try to remove it from your heart. 2 Corinthians says we are not to be ignorant of his devices. He will come to attack this truth. And so immediately after the baptism, after this ordination, let's read together from Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. And it will be on your screen, but it will be taken away after I finish reading it. And so feel free to follow in your own Bibles as well so you can keep your finger on our spot here for today. All right. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, 'You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve.'" He said, "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. So again, Jesus is full of the Holy Spirit at this moment. He receives perhaps the greatest revelation of his entire life about how God the Father feels about him. And then he is led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tested. 40 days in, he's tempted, and it says at the end of this 40 days, he was hungry. At first, I thought this was kind of unnecessary information from Matthew. No kidding, after 40 days of not eating, you think, I understand he's hungry. I just figured Matthew's like the really detail-oriented guy, you know, was a tax collector, so he just wrote it down even though it wasn't necessary information. But the truth is every verse in the Bible matters. There's a significance to it. And the reality is that when you're fasting for that period of time, I've heard it said, I've never fasted this long, but I've heard that after the first couple of days in which you're like freaking out inside because where is that food that I'm so used to? All of a sudden your body realizes this guy is not going to feed me. And so your body will slow down. And eventually you get to like the third or fourth day. And a lot of people say that they don't experience hunger for a while. They realize, okay, my body's storing it. I'm okay. I basically went into hibernation mode like a bear did and I'll make it through. But then after a period of time, you know, 40 days is the max anyone's ever fasted in the Bible. You have Elijah that fasted that long. You had Moses that fasted that long. And here is Jesus' 40-day fasting experience. Towards the end of that period of possibly like life's sustenance, by the end of that period when you feel hunger, it means you're about to die. You're at starvation moment. And so when Matthew is saying that Jesus is hungry, it's not just like when Peter said he was hungry. If you remember the story in Acts chapter 10, when Peter receives a vision, it says Peter went onto the roof to pray, and it was about noon, and Peter was hungry. That's like you and me that I hope the sermon's not going to go long, too long today so that I can get my Taco Bell. I'm feeling a little hungry. That's not what Matthew meant here. Peter was on the weak end of the spectrum, like myself. One time, the most I ever fasted, just to tell you this, it's kind of a funny story, of a pathetic story, but I've done, day fast, and that's plenty intense for me. I did a 3-day fast one time in a really, like, important transitional moment in my life before I ended up going to seminary and was wrestling what my future was. By the second day, my body was hurting so badly, I went to Walgreens, the great American company Walgreens, and I bought muscle patches. And I put muscle patches on my body because I was hurting so badly. It was the second day and Jacob was hungry. But Jesus, this is his 40th day period. He's in the greatest point of vulnerability in his life. And I want to say that to us, is that first of all, when we receive true revelation of who God is, be careful because the enemy is going to wants to attack. If it is revelation from God, Satan is afraid and he wants to stop that. But also, when we're at our spiritually, when we're at our physically weakest state, our emotionally weakest state, our spiritually weakest state, when we're most vulnerable, Satan is most ruthless. And I've seen this happen many times in my own life, but many of the people that I've been blessed to be around in house churches, pastoring, hearing stories. And sometimes people have a hard day, a hard week, a hard month, and it just feels like it keeps on going because Satan is relentless and he will pursue you to suck out all the truth of God that he gave to your heart. And we see that happen with Jesus at his most difficult, vulnerable state when he's not just regular hungry, but he's at the end of this 40-day fast and his body is about to break down and he feels like he's dying of starvation. This is when the devil comes to him. And he comes to him with an attack against his identity. He says what? If you are the Son of God. When he's weakest, that's when after you've had this great revelation experience and then some time goes by, and when you're weak, he'll try to remove all that from your heart. And he says, if you are the Son of God, trying to remove exactly what God had just said 40 days before that, he will come and he will attack your identity. And so if it is true that it's not just Jesus that we can say that about, that the Father loves you with that measure, that he's pleased, he delights in you. If that's true, not just about Jesus, but about you, it's also true that you can expect he will come and attack your identity with that very truth that God the Father put inside of you. If you really are the Son of God, then what? If you are a child of God, then he's going to attack that very identity when you're at your weakest state. Now, what's interesting about this word of temptation that's used here, and often this is called Jesus' temptations, this word actually has an ambiguous meaning in Greek, and I believe that was intentional. Temptation can be what the devil does to try to remove all understanding of what God put in there, or corrupt it, or make it weird, or, you know, bring poison to the truth that God brought, which is what he's trying to do here. Lead you into sin, lead you into reflecting poorly on the character of God. But it can also be translated a test. At the same time that Satan is tempting Jesus to be derailed on the truth of his identity, how this would actually look in terms of what being the Son of God looks like, at the same time, God is testing Jesus to prove his faithfulness. Remember, it was the Holy Spirit that led Jesus into the wilderness. And so the good news is, while we don't like the attack of Satan coming, while we wish he didn't come attack our identity and this amazing truth that we are children of God, we also can understand the sovereignty of God behind this, that he, at the same time that Satan is trying to tempt us, that God is producing a fruitful test that he wants you to be successful in, that he will give you the ability to be successful in. And that's what we see here with Jesus. And there's three temptations, particularly, that we see in this place of Jesus being at his weakest state. My sermon title for today is titled The Identity Test, because I don't want to give Satan the credit only for the temptations. I want us to remember that in the same way that the enemy comes to attack, God is working at an identity test inside of us to prove that we are, in fact, children of God, and that we will be successful in this journey of faith with the Lord Jesus Christ. So the first temptation, that though it may look different in our lives from Jesus' exact temptation, I believe we can find parallels, we can find principles that we can also understand Satan will come and try to attack in these very areas relating to our identity. The first one is the temptation to idolize my bread. The first temptation that Satan says, if you are the Son of God, why don't you turn the stone into bread? Now, idolizing means we're finding satisfaction in this thing apart from God. Bread in itself is a darn good thing, right? Swearing is not holy, right? When Jesus is at the point of starvation, it would sound pretty good to have some bread in that moment. And actually, during Jesus' earthly ministry, when he was with his disciples, remember, they called him a glutton. They're like, you're eating so much. You're just fellowshipping with your believers, so you don't have to feel bad about enjoying the Taco Bell today. The bread can be a good thing, but Satan was tempting Jesus, and I believe he will try to tempt us as well, to idolize our bread, to idolize the physical at the expense of the breakthroughs for us spiritually. Said another way, in 1 John, one of the sins is called the lust of the flesh. I believe this is what is being highlighted here. The lust of the flesh is everything that appeals to my carnal and my physical appetite. And again, many of these can be good things. Food is a wonderful thing. Sex, for example, in marriage, it's a wonderful thing. Exercise is a wonderful thing. Money is a wonderful thing. The love of money, be careful of, but many of these physical things are gifts from the Lord. Please send in your money for the books. You know, it's a wonderful thing. We need, we appreciate the bread. Please give us the daily bread, right? But the devil can use these good, licit desires to enslave men. And in this category of temptation, we see Satan often in our lives use good things to produce illicit carnal passions. Gluttony, fornication, the love of money, covetousness. And the Israelites succumbed to this type of sin as well when the devil tried to tempt Jesus by the lust of the flesh, when he urged him to turn stones into bread. In the Israelites' case, it was sit down, eat and drink, rise up to play. Said another word, eat, drink, and be merry, says the writer of Ecclesiastes. Physical at the expense of our spiritual lives. We don't want a Greek mindset that says the body is bad and the spiritual is good, but at the same time, the enemy loves to use, Susie had talked about in the beginning of her sermon, that sometimes you feel like you just need a vacation, you just need some sleep. You take that vacation you were dreaming of, you go to Jeju-do, you get the nice ocean front, you eat delicious seafood, you come back, you don't have any more energy, you don't feel any joy in your heart. Why? It's because you found out that you didn't connect to God on that trip. You got everything physical that you thought you needed, and praise God for nice hotels and nice food. God loves to also give gifts like that sometimes. He loves to give the fatted calf at the right occasion. But if that's only thing we're pursuing, Satan often wins. And sometimes he'll do it with your identity and say, you deserve this. You're entitled to this. You deserve a little break. Praise God for breaks again. But is it in the will of God? For Jesus, it was not yet the time. Though his body was telling him it was the time for that food, the Father did not say it was time. And sometimes we downplay our addictions to these things. I want to tell us right now that if you have a problem with hangriness, if you're one of those people that I'm just hangry, you got to feed me, maybe God might be putting his finger on something in your life that's holding you captive. Now, you might not go 40 days, but you can go longer than Peter and I did. Our physical flesh is weak, and if not brought under the dominion of what God says, we will live only to seek physical comfort and pleasure above all else, and will seek it exactly the same way that the world offers. If your relationships with Christians starts to look exactly like with your unbeliever friends, you're just eating good food and having nice conversation, but you're not actually pursuing God together, eventually, I would ask, where are the allegiances in the relationship? Just because you're hanging out with a Christian doesn't mean it's fellowship. Now, I don't think every time we should push, like, the tell me your testimony. You know, sometimes we can be a little bit intense where you're like, dude, I just got here. Like, let's share our burrito bowl first. But maybe the Lord actually has a plan for some of the conversations today that it goes deeper than just kind of the natural, shallow, the same way that any conversation happens. Maybe there's more than just idolizing bread that can so often happen. And, you know, interestingly enough, Jesus does eventually miraculously do miracles regarding bread, right? He miraculously multiplies the bread later on, but it's in God's timing. Jesus' trust that the Father will provide. I think one of the issues that this deals with identity and our sonship is not just our lust of the flesh, but also trusting that God will meet my needs even when it's extreme need, even when it's urgent need. I remember in my own journey of faith, After I became a believer, it wasn't maybe that long within the year that I came to faith. The year before, I was working in China as an independent contractor. So basically what that means is all the money I was making, I didn't have to tell anybody about. It just ended up in a bank account. I.e. people that are waitresses or these kind of things, there's often temptation to just leave it hidden in the bank account. But I come to faith and I was feeling like maybe this is gray area or maybe it's sin or probably sin, but I was hoping it was gray area. You know, we do that sometimes. Our gray area is much wider than the narrow road of Christ. But I had made all this money and I was beginning my career. And at that time in 2011, I thought this is the beginning of my future earning, you know, power. I was working at Groupon, which is like a hot internet company back in the day, and it was making money, and it was an exciting time. And then God dramatically changed my life, and I became a Christian. And suddenly, then I'm like, well, what do I do about taxes, tax season when it comes around? And is it a gray area? I don't think so, but I hope so. And I started to really freak out. You know, tax deadline is April 15th, I believe, in the States, and it's like end of March, early April, and I'm thinking about, you know, how much I made, and I'm thinking I might owe like $40,000, you know, and I don't have $40,000 in my account. God was really impressing upon me about the importance of giving, and I was, you know, going to different ministries and flying around and trying to get the Father's heart for this and that. I was just like, I was in Kansas City, I would fly to Toronto, I was doing all this stuff. And so the money was starting to drain, and it even got to the point where the stocks that I had that I was like, I never want to sell, had to sell some ones for like big losses, you know, that you're like, eventually the stock's going to come around. But the money was running out, so I'm having to sell, you know, this money. I don't have, at the end of the day, I don't have this $40,000, $50,000, whatever I could owe in taxes. But I'm wrestling with the Lord, like, I want to do the right thing by you. I want to honor you. I want to honor you with my finances. And so about a two-week period right before that deadline, I'm literally going back and forth. Am I going to cheat on my taxes or not? I'm not using the word cheat, but I'm just not going to tell them. All right? I'm not going to be forthcoming about this. And then one day I'm like, I'm just going to do the right thing, but then I couldn't get myself to go to the account, to the tax place. And then the next day I'm like, oh, but I can't, Lord. You don't understand, you know? So I'm back and forth, like every couple of days, should I go, should I not go? Finally, I'm in a prayer meeting as the deadline's really close. And in the prayer meeting, my friend turns to me, and she says, I believe I heard the Lord speak. She has a little post-it note, and it says, give unto Caesar what is Caesar's. Give unto God what is God's. And the truth is, that was extreme need. And I'm so grateful that I had what I believe to be that prophetic word at that exact moment. But I shouldn't have needed that word anyway. I should have just been able to live by what the word of God already told me. But I'm so grateful for that because it was a reminder that in the midst of those kind of temptations and trials, even in that urgent need, that God still wants me to be successful and do it the right way. And so I did. So I don't know how many I have, but it was much, much short of that amount that in my mind I thought I was going to pay doing my own math. And I went to the tax place, and I just wrote it all out. I'm like, this is how much I made to the exact penny I could figure out. And just like, I don't know what I'm going to do, God. Like, I don't know what happens if you tell the IRS you owe this and then you can't pay it. And then later on, he explains to me as we do all this math, and I'm just freaking out, like, Lord, are you pleased by your son? This is costing me so much, Jesus. And then after about 30 minutes of sitting there and trying to feel the peace of the Lord, he explains to me, have you heard about this thing called the foreign income tax exclusion? And probably many of you foreigners have heard of this living in Korea, but at the time I didn't know about this. Basically, up to like $100,000+, you can write off all of that money, and then you start paying taxes after that. And so basically, what I thought I was going to have, $50,000 or $60,000, ended up turning into like $800 or some incredible. It was basically wiped out. And the point was, I had to believe that I was going to lose that by trying to be faithful. Maybe you've been in a place like that with tithing, where, you know, tithing is hard sometimes, especially when you're like, I don't know how that bill is going to come forth, but I made a commitment to the Lord that I want to give to him in tithing. And oftentimes that lust for the flesh, the devil's lie will be like, well, in this situation, it's okay. This is an urgent need. Everybody else does it. And so I've become a little, maybe even pharisaical about paying taxes now. I told my house church one time I was buying a chair and the guy was trying to save me tax on it. He's like, just send it to this, you know, just give me cash and I'll wipe out, you know, this money. And he's Korean, you know. So I look up the Bible verse in English. I translate it in Korean. I was like, 죄송하지만 저는 기독교인이라서 give unto Caesar what is Caesar's. But I have a fear of the Lord on that because God touched that area in my life. And I don't want to give in to that desire for that lust of the flesh. Even what doesn't feel like that big of a deal, personally, I feel like it is a big deal before my God. And so maybe your idol is like rest, it's calmness, it's exercise, it's safety, it's shelter, financial security, stability. There's different areas that are good in and of themselves, and we'll tell ourselves, because maybe I'm a son of God, or because of who I am, because I've worked this hard for you, God, I deserve all these things. And he puts his finger on those sometimes. And he did that with Jesus. We can idolize our bread. Number two, in my own journey, I found myself idolizing my kingdom. Jesus was tempted to receive all the kingdoms from Satan if he would just bow down and worship him. And for me, in my journey, I've realized that oftentimes it's not just the physical way that I seek to fulfill longings inside of my heart. It's also through success, through power, through authority, through a job, different ways like that, that I realize as I've considered my journey, that sometimes I'm trying to fill a void that's in my heart. And I'm seeking my own kingdom. A kingdom in the Bible is, it's a people group or a political region that a ruler would lead. And so most of us, I'm guessing, wouldn't fit the bill for being a king or a queen. I don't think we have any mayors. I know we have some people kind of in political spheres. But for me, what I felt like the Lord was highlighting is having any amount of influence over a group of people can sometimes become your own idol, where you choose a shortcut because of that sense of identity or security or joy you can feel over leading your kingdom. It may be a big kingdom, maybe a small kingdom, but it's a sense of security, happiness that can be apart from God if you're using that to fulfill your own heart. And for me, I mentioned, you know, I worked at Groupon in the past. It really, this is before I became a believer, it was like all in my head. I was 24 years old, 25 years old. I was leading 100 people in the city of Guangzhou for this company that was kind of the hot thing at that time. There was a Forbes article about Groupon, fastest growing company of all time, faster than Facebook. They had a Super Bowl ad, you know, and I got in at this really exciting time. I didn't have any connections, any background, and I was working with all these people who were Harvard MBAs, who were brought in from the elite consulting companies, you know, Goldman Sachs. You know, it was the place to be. It was super exciting. And I started off with a team of like 7 Chinese salespeople, ended up leading all the sales in Beijing, and then I moved to Guangzhou and was leading the whole city at 24 years old. I had like a top floor office, and I was the boss. It was awesome. It was exciting. And I always knew that money and success would not make me happy, to be honest, but I still wanted to enjoy it in my young years. And then all of a sudden, I didn't feel like it gave me any joy anymore. I felt completely empty. And I look now, I look at many celebrities and business titans, and you see the emptiness on so many of their faces. And I can, in some measure, understand what that felt like. I, you know, met a couple of billionaires and was on the path to achieving, you know, what I thought I wanted to achieve in life. I was completely idolizing my kingdom. But it would be a shame for me to believe that only happens before we become a Christian. After the revelation you're a son of God, actually the enemy's attack will keep coming, and it will be stronger than before. There was this prophetic word that was given by Lauren Cunningham of YWAM, and he believed that God spoke to him about how the Lord is going to move through what he called these different kingdoms. Maybe you've heard this, called the Seven Mountain Kingdom Mandate. And one of them, of course, is through business, like what I experienced. Government is the original meaning of this term. Entertainment, media, education, family. You know, your family can also become the idol that you're trying to build, that kingdom that you're building, and sometimes outside of God, to fulfill your own insecurity, your own emptiness. My child is going to get into this school, is going to get this kind of job, so that I feel validated as a mother or a father. People are going to look at me as, you're an amazing husband or wife, you're an amazing mother, so that I feel that sense of validation. I believe we're all in danger of idolizing a kingdom that we have. Maybe you think, oh, that A-type driven personality is not me, but what area of influence do you have in your life? And might you be trying to cover up from some insecurity and pain in your own heart, where you haven't felt that full revelation of the Father's love for you, and so you're trying to look for that love in all different ways in your own kingdoms that are before you. Again, it's not that kingdom is inherently wrong in the same way that the bread isn't inherently wrong. Jesus will one day receive all those kingdoms. But he wasn't going to take the shortcut. He wasn't doing it to fulfill his own desires to feel better about himself. And he certainly wouldn't do it at the expense of worshiping Satan. We don't realize it, but if we idolize our own kingdom, that's where it leads to. You're probably not burning some shrine to Satan, but every time that you give worship to something else other than God, that's in effect what you're doing. It's lack of identity that leads us into idolizing our own kingdom. And the third one, and I found that also as becoming a believer, it often shifts to this one that I think is very easy to miss. Jesus was tempted on the top of the temple, right? First, he's in the wilderness, in the desert, turned the stone into bread. Then he's shown all the kingdoms of the world and say, you're going to have all this right now if you bow down and worship me. And finally, Satan brings him to the pinnacle of the temple, the pinnacle of Jerusalem temple. And he tries to coax Jesus into throwing himself down, and he even quotes scripture, which is a scary thing that Jesus and Satan are having a Bible study together. Who invited that guy, you know? But that's scary, that Satan also can quote scripture. What if Satan comes to you and he says, judge not? Don't you know that's in the Bible? What if Satan comes to you and he says, judge righteously? That's also in the Bible. Are we aware of the context in which we sometimes use verses like this without allowing the enemy to twist scripture that he does here to Jesus? It was true, he's quoting Psalm 91, that Jesus would be protected, but it would be outside of the ways and the will of God. Jesus will oftentimes protect believers in an incredible supernatural way, but it doesn't mean we try it out. You may have heard stories about people that are like, you know, I've heard a testimony of someone doing a drug deal, and then someone shoots a gun at them, and then at that moment, the gun doesn't go off. God supernaturally protected them. He can send his angels to protect us in car accidents and those things, but it doesn't mean we walk across the street and see God's protection at hand. He refused to allow that spectacle to take place. But notice it's at the temple. In fact, the Jewish understanding and expectation is that Jesus will come, or that the Messiah would come to the temple and reveal himself to be the Messiah. Even in Jewish writings, of course, the most important Jewish writing is Malachi chapter 3 of the Messiah coming to the temple. But even the way that the Jews interpreted that scripture is they said this, our rabbis taught that at the time that the King Messiah comes, he will stand on the roof of the temple and will say to Israel, humble ones, the time of your redemption has arrived. And if you don't believe me, look at my light that has shone. So this isn't from the Bible, but this is what religious Jews who are waiting for the Messiah, this is one of the texts that they read. Our rabbis taught that there would be a day in which the Messiah would stand on the temple and show himself of who he is. And yet, Jesus understood it was the wrong timing and refused to use God's house for his own glory. Here's the idol that we can sometimes fall into, is the idol of my temple, the idol of my own church, using God's house to fulfill that same longing inside of me for love and acceptance that maybe I haven't received yet from God the Father, not in fullness. And don't think that in the church we're exempt from this kind of danger, that we can look for acceptance from each other by how I performed in front of you. How was my sermon? Did you like it? Good, because now I feel better about myself. I'm using your acceptance to build myself up, to perpetuate an idol in my own heart. And we can often do this. You know, the truth is that Jesus and Satan were by themselves, right? We only have this account because somehow the gospel writers, Luke, and there's an account in Matthew and a short verse in Mark, somehow they were told this story or heard this story, the Holy Spirit, we don't know exactly, but maybe Jesus told them this story. This could have been just in the annals of lost history had God not revealed that this story happened. And that's the truth of idols in our heart, is most of the time you'll never know. I can act really humble up here, and yet inside, maybe I'm using this platform to fulfill my own needs. You can be serving quietly in the back and yet longing for a place of like, thank you so much for doing this. And I do think we should thank people and appreciate the gifts that he's given us in a church. But if that's what's propelling us, your applause, your thank you, I can be using the temple as my own idol, the place to seek the glory for myself outside of the Lord's timing and the Lord's way. God loves honoring his children. I look forward to that day, and I hope that I will receive an honor before Jesus, you know, on that day. It says if you acknowledge him before men, he's going to throw a party about you when you show up. God's in the business of honoring, and I want our church to have this kind of culture where we're appreciating who we have as people before us. But I want to say that we can rightly honor you and acknowledge you and have it still be an idol in your heart because of a longing that God the Father has not filled for you to feel loved and accepted by your daddy. You can even use the church. Scary, but you can use the church as your idol to fulfill you, to worship you. And Jesus refused to do that as well. You know, 1 Timothy says this. A pastor, a leader of a church, should not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. You know, maybe if when you first experience Christ and if you get to experience a lot of cool things and what he's going to do, that season of encountering Christ for the first time when I did in 2012 was the most exciting season ever. I was like, I would go to bed just thrilled about what God's going to do tomorrow and had, you know, cool, you know, experiences with God, a revelation, these kind of things. But if you don't have God at the same time allowing some kind of trials to come against you, some kind of thorn in the flesh against you like he did to Paul, sometimes these revelations and experience in God can produce an idol in your own heart where you want to exalt yourself, We have to be careful when we're sharing testimonies, when we're wowing people with our gifts. What's the purpose of that? And it's tricky because it's usually not 100% one or the other. Usually there's some truth in wanting to honor God, but then you get kind of carried away and praise the Lord that he works with us on this. But we often can find ourselves using the church to fulfill our own needs that are not being met by the only one who's meant to, God the Father. At the end of the day, this is an issue of worship. We see Satan say, if you will but bow down and worship me. You give in to these idols because we have not rightly understood our identity before God the Father. That's where it will lead to. Your worship will be mixed. Paul says you cannot drink from the cup of the Lord and eat from the table of demons at the same time. And yet our life is often so full of that. Our best self, our true self, is when we feel most accepted, most embraced. We're not acting out of fear. We're not wanting people's affirmation. We have nothing to prove. I woke up today, yesterday as well, was just asking for these truths to touch my heart again. And I've shared this story, and you guys kind of laugh at me. I'm thinking about Matsepo. I was talking to Matsepo about this. But how, when I was in the roughest season of my life in some ways, when I had a herniated disc, and for about a month, I couldn't sleep. I slept max 1 hour a night. That would be it. I was in so much pain in my disc, in my neck. And one night, just so desperate for the Lord, I couldn't sleep, and you just try to fill that time. And I was watching Christian movies, which most of the time Christian movies feel kind of lame and dull, you know? But and maybe they are, but I refuse to believe. And so anyway, I was thinking about Seppo. Love you, sister. We'll watch it one day together, right? But in that time of 3-4 in the morning when I couldn't sleep, I was watching this one movie called Overcomer. And this girl ends up, as every Christian story comes, they end up finding God and finding the truth of who God is. And there's this one scene where, you know, she's asked over and over again, who are you? And she can't really answer the question. And then she ends up meeting Jesus, and she shows up at the school, and she says, ask me who I am. Ask me who I am. And then the teacher's like, okay, who are you, Hannah Scott? And then she goes into this beautiful monologue. I can't repeat it from memory, but it's basically, I am chosen. I am a beloved of God. I am who he says I am. And I watched it again last night. I cried again. It's holy, man. It's holy. We're going to have a movie night, and you guys are going to see. But the point is, I woke up this morning with that in my heart. And I said, I don't care if I do a terrible job preaching. I mean, I'd love to do a good job, but that's not why I'm here. I am loved by God the Father, and it doesn't actually matter at some level how I do. Now, do I want the message to hit? Do I want some of your hearts to be touched? You bet I do. I do take that, you know, seriously as well before the Lord. But that's not the first thing I'm thinking about. I want to experience God the Father's pleasure over me, whether or not I did a good job. Even if I didn't do that tax thing correctly, I think you can experience displeasure of the Lord because he's after disciplining his children he loves. But even in that place, you can still find the pleasure of your daddy towards you. And I am who he says I am. If that is true for your life, you know, she was reading through the book of Ephesians. So maybe it's not the movie. Maybe it's the book of Ephesians that will change your life. But if that's true, if I know who my Abba Father is, suddenly the idol of bread, the desire for that will go away. I can enjoy bread and have it not control me. That idol for influence, for people appreciating how well we led the house church, that can go away. And the only thing that's left is me wanting to serve you out of love because I've received that full acceptance and love from my daddy. I'm not going to use the church to fulfill that need. I'm not going to use my wife to fulfill that need. Those who want to get married, I'll just say, do not expect a future spouse to fulfill that need that only God the Father ever can. Or you will destroy your marriage, you will destroy your kids' relationships, you will destroy your job, your business, if at the end of the day you're looking to be fulfilled outside of the only one who was ever meant to fulfill it. I wanted to show a little picture. It's funny, old memory lane, the one that says Scott K. Anyone ever heard of this brand, Scott K? Engagement rings, right? So before Amy and I got married, I didn't surprise her with the exact ring. You know, I wasn't one of those who wanted to create the whole ring. I think that's really romantic. And for those who want to get married and you're going to propose one day, if you can pull it off, do that. That's awesome. I think that customizing is actually in the heart of God. Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. So he made the architectural plans, right? But, you know, for those who know Amy, she knows what she wants in a lot of ways. And so I just wanted to have a feel for what kind of ring she was looking for. So about a month or so before we get engaged, we go ring shopping at a couple places. And this is the ring that she particularly loved. I believe it's the second one. It looks awfully familiar. Expensive, right? And so we're at the store at looking at, I mean, they had different designer rings, and I saw the Scott K one that she liked. And I had a certain amount of money I was planning on spending, and it's like the maximum amount that I'm planning on spending. You know, if you go to a car dealership, like, I'm going to spend up to $10,000, you bet it's going to end up at $10,000. You'll always, like, get to the level you have. So anyway, I had the amount of money in my mind, what I'm going to pay. Find the ring. I'm like, wow, this is beautiful. You know, it's got what's called a halo. So holy, right? A lot of diamonds around there. It's like, wow, this is beautiful. How much is it? Okay, that's like kind of at the limit, even a little bit more, but okay, we can maybe pull this off. And then after that, after I already make kind of the decision, we'll probably do this one, he says, oh, this is just the setting. You know what a setting is? It's everything but this. Everything but the main course. And so what that amount of money that I was going to pay was for the halo, for the just the... Everything but, you know, the main part. And then I'm, like, freaking out. Obviously, you know, my heart is to give her, like, what she wants and that it would feel romantic. And then she's kind of feeling bad, and she's like, it doesn't have to be a diamond. It can be a moissanite, you know. She's thinking about alternative, you know, things like that. But you never feel good about that. Like, it can be, it's a second choice. It's okay. Like, am I going to put an IOU in the middle? Like, freaking out, you know? And then, of course, so then I'm trying to figure out how can I lower the cost. You know, for those who know me, whether I have money or not, I just have to find a way to lower costs on things. To the point where maybe it's an idol sometimes, and the Lord is teaching me probably about that. But I'm like, I gotta figure out a way to lower this cost. And so sure enough, there is a way, for those who are looking in the future, you can consider this, is you can find the exact one you want, take a picture. Usually they don't want you to take a picture because of this reason, and then find someone else to make it cheaper than the designer. It's everything but the name on it, okay? And it can be pretty close to the exact thing, a replica of it, basically. They see what it looks like, and they're like, yeah, we can make it look pretty close. And so for about 20-30% of the price, I could make the exact one in setting. But then I look at the website one more time, and it says, never compromise. And so I don't believe that was a sin issue whatsoever, but I wanted to express my relationship, the way I felt about the relationship, and when never compromise is staring at you in the eyes, it's really hard to go through and get that cheaper version of the same one. And so anyways, I was like, I bought the bullet and figured out how to make it work, and end up looking for the diamond. It ended up being cool, end of the story. So I was looking everywhere for where I could get a diamond. Ended up finding a wholesaler in Israel, actually. And I tried my discount techniques with them, too. I was like, I'm a Christian, and I love Israel. You can save $30. Thank you so much for your love. And didn't get me very far, but anyway, I expressed my love for the fellow Jew. And at the end of the day, you know, so we got the setting, we got the diamond. And it's kind of a silly analogy. I'm glad at the end of the day I did give that ring to Amy. One time, Amy and I got in a fight at the first retreat, and Luna says to Amy, "Just look at the ring. Look how he loves you." Amy did not like that, but it's true. I was trying to express my love in that moment. Remember that? But I believe the analogy in some ways shows about our relationship with God. That if we rightly understand that relationship, if we rightly understand what Pastor Susie preached on of the delight of how my daddy feels about me, suddenly that desire for compromise is going to disappear. Now, we're still going to fall. We're never going to make it perfectly. That's what is called sanctification, this journey of being made cleansed and holy before God. But you can have breakthrough in these areas. You can look back years later and say, you know, I had this area of temptation of idolatry for bread in the past, or using the church for my own gain, or selfish ambition. And God is changing my heart. And I hope you have some experiences like that where you look back and you say, God is doing a work. And sometimes it's when my sister visited me and she saw how I didn't freak out at the staff for messing up the order and overcharging me like 3 times. And I wasn't trying to be more holy in that moment, but she just kept saying, "I'm sorry." And I'm like, "It's okay. Thank you. Like, take your time." And then she said to me afterwards, she's like, "Wow, you've changed." Does that mean every time I've always been nice and responded in the way that I wanted to? No. But there are moments I can look back and say the Holy Spirit's working. I'm not using people to fulfill my needs like I used to. And he wants to work the same in you because of that security of identity you have before your daddy. I invite the worship team to come up. So the reality is, as we started with, is that you're to expect temptation to come in your life, especially the more you say, "I'm going to make this truth real. I'm going to ask Holy Spirit for you to give me more truth about how my dad feels about me." If you make a determination in your heart, maybe last week that happened in some measure, maybe years ago it happened, today again, you're like, "I want that truth to be real." And I hope you do make that commitment to say, "God, let me feel your love for me." At the same token, you should expect that temptation will follow. But know that it's the Lord's testing to prove that you have changed, to prove that you are changing, to prove that Jesus is doing a great work in you, and that God the Father is saying that you are who I say I am. And that truth we combat, or that temptation we combat with the truth, with speaking the word of God over ourselves. If you feel that accusation come against you, I've had many times where I feel this phrase come in my head, "You're an idiot." I can tell you right now, that's not from God. And maybe that's me, but that's how the enemy accuses, adding to that. And when those thoughts come, I don't know how your self-talk looks. Pastor Susie again said, if I talk to people the way that I talk to myself, I wouldn't have friends. I'm guessing that just like you can experience God's Father's love to you, you can probably relate to different areas of self-talk, that self-harm, that's straight from the pit of hell, mixed with our own emotions of sickness, of sadness, of hurting. But the enemy seeks to allow us to perpetuate these lies to us. And when those come, we combat with the truth of who God says we are. And number 3 is we expect that he will not only allow us to get through the testing, but he will deliver us fully and he will care for us at the end. I love how this ends. It's actually in the account in Matthew. It says that when he resisted the devil, James talks about it as submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. He resists the devil with the word of God, with speaking who he is, by refusing to give in to the enemy's timing, by refusing to give in to any of those idols. And then the angels come and they minister to him. You know, Jesus was hungry. He was starving. He actually needed a breakthrough. It was urgent. And yet he refused to accept anything other than the Lord's way and the Lord's timing. And God came triumphantly, released his angels to minister to Jesus at the end. There's a moment of victory, a moment of celebration. It's not just the day you meet the Lord, though that will be the ultimate time of celebration. But you get through a testing like that, and you will feel the Father saying, you passed this test. And here's the good news. You don't have to do it 100%. He'll sometimes give you allow the same test to come over and over again because he's like, it's all right. You have another chance. You didn't pass that yesterday. Take it again today. Just remember how I feel about you. And you'll have a chance over and over again until the day you meet the Lord. Because he will do whatever he can to say, well done, good and faithful servant. My beloved child, you made it. There is a deliverance coming. And there's a day of feeding that's coming. There's a day of kingship that's coming. And there is a day of right priesthood that is coming. For Jesus, and for those who walk as children of God with him. There's a wedding supper of the Lamb in which every appetite that was not allowed to be enjoyed, that we're going to celebrate with Isaiah 25 talks about choice meats. I love that. Meat eaters are going to be in heaven, I'll just say that. The best hanu you could ever imagine. There's kingship in which one day Jesus will be the King of Kings over the entire earth. Zechariah chapter 14 tells us there's a day coming in which he'll rule as king from the entire earth. He refused the kingship then, but he's going to receive that one day. And you are also going to be part of that kingship. If you don't use the church for your own means, you'll also get to enjoy being part of that priesthood with your high priest. Revelation says, kings and priests with our God forever. We trust the Lord's timing, the Lord's way. Satan was disarmed. We only give him power if we believe the lies that he speaks to us today. But we silence that. We silence those lies of accusation of identity. I speak over myself right now. I'm asking for a breakthrough, Lord. Why not today for me, Lord? That for areas in which I've looked to have my needs met through applause of men, set me free in greater measure. I pray for those who are gathered here that you've dealt with dark thoughts, self-hatred, that maybe no one else will possibly know but you and God and the enemy. Maybe very few are aware of your journey that you're in. But I want to say there's freedom again in the name of Jesus. You are who the Father says about you. He enjoys you. With everything that he has. You are his favorite one. He loves your quirks, your silliness. Maybe you feel like, I do this thing, I say this thing, people will be annoyed. Jesus loves the way that he fashioned you perfectly. God the Father loves the way that he made you. Psalm 139 says you are perfectly fashioned, perfectly made in the womb of heaven, in your mother's womb. Set us free from the temptations of the enemy that seek to derail our lives, that seek to derail the purpose of God. And I speak success in the name of Jesus. Not based on performance, but because he loves you. Because he enjoys you. When you were born, the Father went out to buy you ring, to buy you earrings. He went out to celebrate you. He's got the fatted calf ready for you. Even when you come back and you didn't deserve a lick of meat. You don't even deserve panchan. But he says, here it is. He spreads the table before you. Set us free in the name of Jesus. Let us find our security, our safety before you. And let that be the fuel to lead us out of compromise in our lives, out of idolatry in our lives, of the lesser pleasures in our life. I bless my friends, my brothers and sisters. We're on this journey together, and you are free in Christ, free in the Beloved, because of the blood of Jesus and the Father's love for you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Let's close with a song together as we worship our Father.